Self-pity plants its flag in the feeling, plants its flag in one's heart that God has abandoned us and our situation is hopeless. No use in praying or doing anything about it. It's one of the highest forms of pride, because it's convinced itself that God's promises and his words are not reliable. Do you understand what I'm saying? You see, if I identify more of my pain than the promises of God, then I'm no longer walking by faith.
Abounding in Faith is the broadcast ministry of Emmanuel Bible Church of Howell, New Jersey. If you are blessed by this message, please subscribe to our podcast or YouTube channel. You can also download our app by searching for IBCNJ in the Google Play Store or the Apple Store. For more information, please visit us at www.ibcnj.org. Our speaker today is Senior Pastor Joe Suozzo.
God gives permission to Job, or to Satan, to take everything away from Job, and we see in those first chapters, and we looked at it, how Satan attacked his family, taking all 10 of his children through a natural disaster, all his wealth, his servants, possessions, his health, and then even his wife walked away from him. And so there's some great lessons to be learned from this man's life, who struggled like we would and do through suffering, but the testimony of Scripture stands that Job was learning, as we will, and the Lord is present. You see, that's the most important thing. God is present. The doctrine of his omnipresence. He's with us here, right now. Our problem is we're not listening. Our problem is we let our pain so fill our hearts that we put God on the periphery and let all the noises of this world and its struggles to crowd God out. And then we wonder why we lack peace in our tarrying, in our busyness. Last week we looked at really Eliphaz's first response to Job. If you remember, one of Job's first responses after he lost everything was to lament the day he was born. Of all that he had been through, I think some of us here can relate to that. And so Eliphaz, who had no idea why Job was suffering, accuses Job of being a foolish man and disregarding the things of God. And that is the reason why suffering has come his way. And what we learned last week is that so quickly we are prone to judge, are we not? We see someone who's suffering or struggling financially or with whatever issue, and instead of compassion, love, grace, encouragement, we're so quick with our minds and our hearts and even our words to judge others. And it's not the heart of God. It's not the heart of God. This week, we're going to look at Job's response to Eliphaz. And what we're going to discover in Job's response is his temptation with self-pity and self-loathing. One of the hardest persons to encourage, this is my experience in many years of ministry and counseling, one of the hardest persons to encourage and lead to God is someone who is sunk into a place of self-pity or self-loathing. Oxford Dictionary defines defines self-pity as an excessive, self-absorbed unhappiness over one's troubles, while self-loathing is despising or hating one's station in life. Why is a person struggling with self-pity or self-loathing one of the hardest people to reach? It's because that person has convinced themselves that their situation is without hope. And ultimately, when you peel the layer of hopelessness back, you always discover that that person does not believe that God is for them or that his promises apply to their situation. And so a person filled with self-pity is really in an argument with God. I know, Lord, you said you'll provide for my needs, but why have you allowed me to be unemployed? Or to enter a time of financial difficulty, or struggling to pay my bills? I know, Lord, you said you'd give wisdom and peace, but why am I in such conflict in my marriage or family or workplace? I know, Lord, you said you'd bring healing, but why, Lord, am I struggling with this chronic pain or illness? And the list goes on. Self-pity plants its flag in the feeling, plants its flag in one's heart that God has abandoned us and our situation is hopeless. No use in praying or doing anything about it. It's one of the highest forms of pride because it's convinced itself that God's promises and his words are not reliable. Do you understand what I'm saying? You see, if I identify more of my pain than the promises of God, then I'm no longer walking by faith. If my pain is enthroned in my heart in the center of who I am and what my identity is, then even though I may confess Christ, actually the pain has become my refuge. I've become more comfortable in my misery than experience the joy of freedom. So Job's response in Job chapters 6 and 7 is a response of self-pity about his situation. And it's hard to argue with a man who's lost everything, his children, his wealth, his health, his wife. And so self-loathing here seems like a reasonable response to a life that's gone bad. But we know at the end of the book of Job that God does not give Job a pass on some of these attitudes that he allowed to come into his heart. And God basically calls all of us to trust him, no matter how difficult the journey may be. A call to walk by faith, even when things look hopeless. So I'd like you to stand as we read some verses together from Job chapter 6 and 7. We're not going to read those entirely, but I just want to give you a little bit of a snapshot of the beauty of these verses of Scripture. We're going to pick it up in verse 8 of chapter 6. Job speaking now, responding to his friend Eliphaz. Oh, that I might have my request, and that God would fulfill my hope, that it would please God to crush me, that he'd let loose his hand and cut me off. This would be my comfort. I'd even exult in pain unsparing, for I have not denied the words of the Holy One. What is my strength that I should wait? And what is my end that I should be patient? Is my strength the strength of stones Is my flesh bronze? Have I any help in me when resource is driven from me? He who withholds kindness from a friend forsakes the fear of the Lord. My brothers are treacherous, as a torrent bed, as torrential streams that pass by, which are dark with ice, and where the snow hides itself. Now over to chapter 7, verse 7. Remember, my life is a breath. My eye will never see good again. The eye of him who sees me will behold me no more. While your eyes are on me, I shall be gone. As the cloud fades and vanishes, so he who goes down to Sheol does not come up. He returns no more to his house, nor does his place know him anymore. Father, we pray as we just go through some of these verses that your Spirit, the great instructor, would speak to our hearts, that we may learn to suffer joyfully and with the strength to bring you glory. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. So we're going to break these two chapters up, keeping things simple, to two pieces. The first section, chapter 6, we're going to look at self-loathing as we respond to others. Self-loathing as we respond to others. And then in chapter 7, we're going to look at self-loathing and our response to God. In our deepest times of discouragement, those two responses are what will define our faith and our character. So let's look at self-loathing and others. Now, Job's first response in Job 6 can be summed up this way. No thank you, Eliphaz. God has abandoned me. No thank you. God has abandoned. Remember, Eliphaz's response was trying to convince Job that his longing for death was not good. And he's trying to convince his friend that he needs to turn from his sin and foolishness, and God in his time will restore him and lift him up. But remember, the problem of Eliphaz, and often with us, is when we respond to those who are suffering, is that he didn't really know why Job was suffering. So when we look at Job 6, Job now doubles down. I like that expression, double down. He doubles down on his response to his friends, Eliphaz, and he begins his first response with, "No, thank you, friends. My longing for death is reasonable because God has abandoned me." Look at verses 2 through 7 in Job 6. If my vexation or trouble could be weighed, it would be heavier than the sand of the sea. In other words, Eliphaz, you can't possibly imagine what I'm going through. I looked up on my phone. I like these Google searches sometimes. How much does all the sand of the sea weigh? Believe it or not, people have taken time to try to figure that one out. One guy, and I have no idea how he got there, 10 to the 127 power. Now, for those of you who have a little bit of familiarity with mathematics, that's like an infinite number that our minds cannot grasp or understand. I mean, what is that, 10 with 127 zeros after it? It's just beyond our comprehension. If my vexation or trouble could be weighed, it would be heavier than the sand of the sea. That's pretty bad, isn't it? Look at verses 4 through 7. For the arrows of the Almighty are in me. The terrors of God are against me. Look, friends, You see how bad my suffering has become? Just as, look at how he goes on. And this is where you need to understand the Hebrew language. As a donkey doesn't bray or make noise when grazing, or when an ox is eating, just as food is tasteless without salt, or herbs like mallow, which is a tasteless herb, is tasteless, so my situation is so bad that death, my desire for death, is a reasonable response. I even stopped eating. This is an argument. Remember what we talked about last week? This is like a courtroom scene. Job is the defendant. Eliphaz and the other friends are the prosecutors, and God is the only one who can judge rightly in the book. The reason we find Job's source of bitterness so deep is not just his suffering, which is real, but his belief that God has abandoned him. And this is true of us at times, for both believers and especially for the unbeliever. For the believer, the thought may go something like this. If God is supposed to be my refuge and my strength and my ever-present help in trouble, then why do I feel unsafe? Why do I feel anxious? Why do I feel weak in an absence of his presence? God himself must be against me. His arrows and terror are aligned against me. One problem with his reasoning is that that is not what God has declared to us. And remember what we talked about. What does it mean to walk by faith? It means not to walk according to my circumstances or according to the feelings and my emotions or the way my mind will carry me, but we're walking according to the promises of God, and my confidence and my strength and my victory and my understanding that I'm a conqueror comes through the promises that God has declared to me. Listen to the way the Apostle Paul asks this question in Romans. If God is for us, who can be against us? And then he proceeds with a long list of things. Shall tribulation or distress or famine or danger or sword or death or life or angels or rulers or things present to come? No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. That's God speaking to us. Now here, we have a little bit more of an advantage than Job. While Job had a faint glimpse of Jesus, and we're going to see that in a few weeks, we have a full view. Listen to what the Apostle Paul says here in Romans 8. Nothing could be against us. Can you take that this morning? Can you receive it? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how much more will he graciously give us all things? Wow. Nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. And so for us as believers, we have a hope. Hope beyond our circumstances, hope beyond our feelings, hope beyond whatever this world would throw at us. It's rooted in God's declaration to us that through Christ, we're forgiven of sin, we have redemption, and eternal life. And though this world is a trouble-filled place, remember what Jesus said? He says, in this world you'll have what? Trouble. But take heart. I've overcome the world. Now, the believer doesn't have this hope. That's why we do backpack ministries. We have a bluegrass festival coming up, hopefully, October 1st. We want to be reaching out in the name of Jesus to a hurting world. The unbeliever doesn't have hope. They will often say this, and we know, those of us who've talked and reasoned with loved ones, friends, if God is good, if God is loving and able to rescue me, why do I continue to suffer? Why is this world so filled with evil, injustice, and hardship? The unbeliever is saying the fact that the world is the way it is proves that God is non-existent or is somehow on the periphery or worse, amoral or not good. Why should I accept God's word and his challenge to trust him when the world is in this state? In the book, The Existence of God, the author Simmons shares in his chapter, Understanding Evil, an article published by CNN in 2019. The name of the article is this, Why I Raise My Children Without God. That's the name of the article, Why I Raise My Children Without God. The author of the article, Deborah Mitchell, said that the number one reason she raises her children without God is because of evil in the world. How could a loving God allow murder, wars, torture, millions of other heinous crimes in history, quote unquote? Her solution in the article is a worldview of what is called materialistic evolution. When we talk about materialistic, we're not talking about a love for money. We're talking that world without a spiritual dimension to it. It's just stuff. And so her solution was materialistic evolution, quote unquote, we're just a very, very small part of a big, big machine. Our influence to change things is minuscule, she says. It's better that we accept our insignificance. And so the world's solution to the biblical view that man is created in God's image, that man is significant, has a free will to choose evil or good, and that he loves us, is the dark view of our insignificance and our inability to change things. And we wonder why our youth is struggling with hopelessness in a godless secular culture. No hope for the future? Should we wonder why we're seeing a descent of our culture into immorality and conflict and chaos, and teenage and adult suicide and depression are an all-time high? You see, without the view that we've been created in the image of God and have infinite worth, infinite significance, and that through God we can be delivered of our troubles, there's just hopelessness and despair. And we see it in our culture today. So Job's first response to Eliphaz, no thank you. No thank you, Eliphaz. God has abandoned me. His second response to Eliphaz is, and this is where he doubles down again, no thank you, death would be better than life. Look at verses 8 through 13, chapter 6. Verse 8, what is Job's request and hope here? Verse 9, that God would finish the job and crush him and cut him off. That would be his comfort in verse 10. If Job knew God would do that, then he, look at verse 11, would have joy in the midst of pain. But why, he says, should I be patient with this request? Because probably God's not going to grant it anyway. That's dark. I mean, this is about as low as any of us can go when we see our circumstance and would rather die than live. This is absolute hopelessness. No amount of words here was going to convince Job, by the way. Look at verse 15 at the end of the chapter. Chapter 6, Job basically accuses his friends of being fair-weather friends. Again, the Hebrew language, like a torrent bed. Well, what is he saying there? That is here today with a storm. It's a rushing stream, but gone tomorrow. Verse 18, like a caravan passing through. Look at verse 26. You think you could persuade me of words? A man like me in despair whose life has come to nothing? You're not in your right minds, friends. You cannot. Wow. Self-loathing. I've been there. I think most of us have been there, where we just feel like the situation's hopeless. And we see it in Job. Now, Job's response to his friends is different than his response to God, but still self-loathing. Looking at chapter 7 now, Job begins by lamenting and stating the obvious. The brief nature of life and its meaninglessness in the light of suffering. He's complaining to God here in this chapter. His lament begins with the feelings of meaninglessness of life when you look at how short it is in the light of our struggles. Verse 1, look it. Has not man a hard service on earth, and are not his days like the days of a hired hand? True. When Job looks at the hardness of his situation, we see in verse 3, he calls them months of emptiness, which are characterized by nights of sleeplessness. Misery apportioned to me. And then verse 4, as soon as the night begins, they bring no rest. They're long and full of tossing. And then he summarizes the vanity of it all and describes his life like a breath. Without the hope of seeing good, verses 7 and 8, verse 9, like a cloud fading and vanishing, so our lives on earth when death comes, going down to Sheol, or that would be the Hebrew word for the grave or death itself. Job's pointing out something that's true of all of us. Life is brief. Some of you are in your 20s, 30s, see a few in their 40s. 50s, you still can fill your heart with a little bit of sense of invincibility. But once you get up there in your 60s, then you're starting to really see. Life is brief. Life can be trouble-filled. Where is hope to be found in the midst of it? Where can we find joy in this 70 or 80 years? Well, first, we have to remember hope cannot be found in this life. We need something greater than the pleasures we experience that are here today and gone tomorrow. We need something greater than the successes and the achievements that we may have in this world, which are here today and gone tomorrow. We need something greater than the material stuff we may accumulate, which is definitely here today and not there tomorrow. The meaning that we find on earth can only be found in God Himself. Here's where Job was tempted with bitterness, just like we are. Paul in Romans 8, going back to this amazing chapter of scripture, Romans 8, he says he considers the present sufferings not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed. Paul is able to say that because he had faith and confidence in what God had declared, that even though this world was subjected because of sin to judgment, and decay, that's why death has come, because of sin. God has subjected it, Romans 8 says, to futility in hope. In hope, what's the hope? The hope to be found here in these few short, painful days on earth are to be found in the promise that God, through our redemption in Christ, has given us eternal life. And through Christ, we can live abundantly despite the discouragements that come our way, even when we cannot discern why God has allowed suffering in our lives. I like the way Paul held on to his hope in trial and reminds us this way in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 8, we're afflicted in every way, but not crushed. Do you like that? Perplexed, but not driven to despair. Then a few verses later in 2 Corinthians 4:18, we don't lose heart. Though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. So this lightweight, momentary troubles is achieving for us a glory beyond our imagination. So I don't look on that which is seen. I look on that which is unseen. For that which is seen is temporary, passing. But that which is unseen is eternal. Wow. To walk by faith means is my eyes are on that which is unseen. Before he prays before us this amazing group of Old Testament saints in Hebrews 11, he says this, faith is the assurance of the things hoped for. What are the things hoped for? The things that have been declared by God. The assurance of things hoped for, the confidence of things not seen. By faith we understand that the universe was created by the word of God. And so the things that are seen were not made out of the things that were visible. That's what faith is. And we're called to walk by faith. And so here, ultimately, that's what God is going to be calling Job to later on in the book. One final thing as we look at chapter 7. Question. I think it applies to all of us. Does God really care? Job finishes up in verses 11 through 21 with a complaint against God in light of his troubles. I think we've all been there. His suffering, his sleepless night. Look at verse 11. I'll not restrain my mouth. I'll complain in the bitterness of my soul. One thing I like about Job is he's honest about what he's going through. Instead of God giving Job even one night's comfort and sleep, Job's perspective in verse 14, Lord, you scare me in my dreams. You terrify me with visions. So, Lord, I would choose, he says in verse 15, strangling in death. He's going back to that theme again. Verse 16, I loathe my life. Lord, leave me alone. Verse 20, why have you made me your mark? Verse 21, why do you not forgive my sin, take away my iniquity? Instead, Lord, rather than helping me, you're allowing me to perish. Those are the temptations, my friends, in difficulty. Now we've come around full circle in these chapters. When Job was complaining and debating Eliphaz in Job 6, the Almighty's arrows were in him. And now we see how hopeless Job is here in verse 7 when he's complaining to God himself. I think all of us are hesitant to throw stones at Job. After all, the poor guy lost everything, right? His family, his money, everything. But the same hope that Job needed back then is the same hope we still need today. Assurance from God that everything will be okay. I'm asking you this morning, do you have that assurance in your hope, in your heart? That everything is going to be okay. I know things are crazy in Afghanistan. I know we're all tired of this COVID. I know we're all fatigued by the political nonsense in this nation these days, by the road rage and all the things that are surrounding us. We're all in that place. But do you have assurance from an ever point of view that everything is going to be okay? Because God said, yes, I love you. I love you, and everything is going to work itself out okay. I see your suffering. I'm present with you. Invite me in. I stand at the door and knock. If you just open, I'll come in. I'll sit with you. I'll sup with you. And despite the brevity and the troubles of this life, God gives meaning, purpose, promise of resurrection, and heaven beyond the grave. Jeremiah 29:11, verse familiar to many of us. Thus says the Lord, for I know the plans I have for you. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Father, we thank you for the power of your word. We thank you, Lord, for your love. To us, perfectly expressed in Christ Jesus, crucified. The hope that we have in the Lord, perfectly expressed in Jesus Christ, raised from the dead. And so, Lord, we ask for your presence and your spirit to encourage our hearts, that we may have joy in the journey in the Lord. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.